Hello and welcome to Policy and Politics with me, Tarun Nangia. Today our issue is a special one. We are going to discuss with change makers in the times of Corona. And today we've got a father and a son, both lawyers. One is also a parliamentarian. I don't want to create much mystery, so I'll introduce my first guest, Mr. Vivek Tanka. He's senior advocate, member of parliament, Rajya Sabha. He has been the Advocate General of Madhya Pradesh, very well known so. He was also the head of Legal, Human Rights and the Right to Information Department at the All India Congress Committee. And he's actually known as a person who's got relations across communities, across geographies also in a sense. With him we have Advocate Varun Tanka. He is an advocate practicing in Delhi as well as in Madhya Pradesh. Today we're going to discuss about the immense contribution that they have made socially at also great personal cost for the kind of problems we faced during this corona pandemic, how that was done. We are told when we were researching for this episode that hundreds of lawyers were personally helped by Mr. Tanka A, but more than that, they arranged for transport for well over a lakh people, more so approaching governments in well over 25 states, including offices of the Chief Minister, the Civil Aviation Minister, the External Affairs Minister. How this orangutan exercise of helping over a lakh students was done from his office here in Vasant Vihar, we will get to know more today. To more of this, I will introduce you my guest today, Mr. Vivek Tanka and Mr. Varun Tanka. Sir, if you could please detail me that on 23rd of March this year, Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced that he is going in for a lockdown at a notice of 4 hours. Did you have any inkling that you would there would be so much of opportunity to do work that will come your way, or that time you weren't clear it's going to be so much of work that is going to come your way in terms of helping people to get to their homes?
Frankly speaking, I couldn't have known because nobody knew.
Yes.
It came suddenly. The announcement also came very sudden.
Yes.
And next is only when things started deteriorating.
Yes.
Or there was a huge sound or a noise in the country that one realized that, oh, what's happened?
Yes.
And it was a great human issue. And people were suffering. I was getting calls. I was getting mails, friends were calling, relatives were calling, all kinds of people were calling. It was Rotary, it was other organizations, politicians, everybody, across lines.
Across,
everybody. And then you realize people are stranded in the, when they were stranded in their home, that's okay, because you are safe at least in your home.
Yes.
When people are stranded in other towns, other cities, in other states.
It was sudden.
It was all sudden. My first foray was when I got calls from Justice Karju. And he said, Vivek,
Justice Markande,
Karju. In fact, he asked me for help for the Kashmiri migrants.
Kashmiri migrants.
And he says, Vivek, in thousands, they are stranded all over the country and all over the world.
Thousands.
Yes. So he had formed a Chinar Foundation where he anointed me as the vice chairman. I didn't want any position, but he said, you have to become one.
Yes.
And we said, let's work. And then there was a group which started working. And the first thing I did was started writing for these students. This was March or early April. I started calling for these students, writing for them. And there were about 600 students stranded in Bhopal, Indore, Ujjain, Jabalpur, and Gwalior.
Okay.
And they were all crying for help.
They wanted to get to their homes.
Yeah, and they were emotional wrecks. And this continued till end of April.
Oh.
They were emotional wrecks. Some were threatening suicide.
It was the situation?
I can show you the mails.
Yes.
They said, and they were crying. Half of them were girls, or more than half were girls. They were locked. They didn't have places to eat. They couldn't go out.
See, many wouldn't have access to food because everything was cold.
Yes, yes. And then that's the time. Then suddenly these same calls started coming from my own state, Madhya Pradesh. People were blocked in the state. Our people blocked outside the state.
Yeah.
Within the state, from one district to another district.
They all reached out to you?
Yes, yes, in thousands.
You got
in
mails?
As mails, you talk, and people are talking, telling me. And when I saw this, it was humongous. And I thought, if I don't help now, I don't think another opportunity like this will come again to help people. I mean, there can't be a bigger lifetime opportunity to serve humanity than to serve your own people.
Yes.
So I decided I should do something.
So I want to know from you, you have done two kinds of help. As while we were researching, we came to know that he's helped well over 1,000 lawyers directly, indirectly, even getting money across to them who are in need. Because we must understand, India is a large country. Practice of lawyers in smaller towns is not as much. There is not enough money. It is really a tough life. It's not that good as in the metros. We heard that you primarily helped first. I mean, of course, you helped a lot of students, but you helped your own community a lot.
Yeah, yeah. I not only helped lawyers, but I also tried to help a lot of munshis, clerks.
Munshis also.
Yeah, yeah. I got lists from districts.
Lists from
and
districts.
And whatever help I could give.
When we were speaking in Madhya Pradesh, we came to know from districts like Mandla,
and
Jabalpur, Narsingpur.
Gadawara, I've got a list right now. So
yes.
Whole kinds of lists.
So these are hundreds and thousands of lawyers and munshis across these districts.
I wouldn't say I helped thousands, but yes. I did help a substantial number.
Substantial number.
Yes. But more than that, I was also fighting with the governments for them. I was telling the chief ministers of Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. I mean, yes. One is Congress and one is BJP.
Yes.
I said, you have collected money in the name of lawyers.
Yes.
You know, we have a cess, which is collected with the court fee,
okay,
which is for the welfare of lawyers. Now, that is 70, 80 crores in Madhya Pradesh.
You could have used it.
That's what I told the chief ministers. That's what I was telling the governments. I said, if you are not going to use this money for the lawyers today in this pandemic, when are you going to use it?
Yes.
Frankly speaking, it belies my comprehension that why was it not done for so long? So I my statements were in newspapers.
So you took it up with chief ministers of both states?
Yes, both states.
You mean Shivraj Singh Chauhan and
Bhupesh Baghel?
You spoke to both?
With equal venom.
Okay.
And I was forthright. I said, you're not doing justice to lawyers and the community of lawyers. And gradually, then the courts also started pushing them.
Yes.
Notices were issued by courts also.
Yes.
And finally, some little amount was given to them.
Okay.
To lawyers across the state. And that was also a minuscule number. I was wondering why, what is this conjusi for? I
mean, the money is for them.
For them. And in a pandemic, if you don't give it to them, when are you going to use it? I mean,
yes.
They said, we use it when people pass away, you know, doctors, lawyers die, the families need it.
But now everybody is in the same.
And it's a self-generating fund.
You don't have to make appeals.
Yes.
You have to mandatorily pay.
No, every time a case is filed, money gets deposited.
Yes.
I said, what is that money for?
Yes.
So, I mean, in two states, I can take credit. To some extent, that I created a lot of pressure on the both governments.
But as I saw from news reports, as a parliamentarian and and also a politician in that sense, you reached out to the External Affairs Ministry, you reached out to the chief ministers for getting people home. And I am told that you also reached out to people in Kazakhstan, Russia and some other countries to get them home.
I'll put it this way. I was getting mails.
Mails from where all?
From all over the world.
So, can you name a few countries?
We got mails from Dubai. We got mails from Kyrgyzstan. Then we got from Russia.
Russia.
Then we got mails from US. We got from European countries.
Okay.
Saudi Arabia. UAE. I can't keep naming.
But
Every day I got 15, 20 mails.
Yes. And these mails had for many students or one student?
No. Sometimes it was groups. Sometimes it was individuals.
So groups as in could be 40, 50 students?
Even 150, 200.
So
or 400. Or 1,000.
Just they wanted to come back.
Back. 1,000 students from Russia sent me a list.
1,000 students?
Yes.
1,000 students?
1,000 students, yes. Medical students.
So how you reached out to the medical students?
Yeah. What I did was, I reached out to the External Affairs Minister. I reached out to the Civil Aviation Minister. And my office was bombarding them with mails every day, even today.
So that's Hardeep Puri.
Hardeep Puri ji and Mr. Foreign Affairs Minister.
Jai Shankar. But when you wrote to them, did they act on it?
I never got a reply. I wish they had sent replies. Huh. But they were acting upon it.
They were acting upon it. So at least that was happening.
Because maybe they were inundated with those requests at that time. So
yes.
Maybe practically replying was difficult.
But they were acting on it.
Because I would send 15 requests a day.
15 a day?
Yeah.
And so, that too for hundreds of students.
For hundreds of them and every day.
Every day.
Even today I've sent mails.
today also.
Yesterday I have sent mails.
Still this problem continues.
Yes. Today I have sent a mail of Kyrgyzstan where 102 students list I have sent.
In Kyrgyzstan.
Yes. I said they are stuck. They want to come back. They are crying. Some of them, that whole area is also COVID affected. When they come back, some of them have to be quarantined because they are infected. So all these issues have taken a huge toll and dimension. And you see that, I mean, you read the mails, you cry.
So basically what they're pleading you?
For mercy. I mean, it is so disheartening to read those mails.
Acha, tell me, can you tell me one thing? There are thousands of politicians in India. And they all know that in times of these, there are problems. What made you take this initiative?
That is a long history, but cutting it short, my family taught me these values.
Because there is no political gain to be sought in
nothing
such
at all.
Yes. It's an expense at the
expense.
Everybody would have said the government will do it.
My father, when I was in school, I saw my father as president of the Rotary Club, and he was one of the top lawyers of Madhya Pradesh.
Yes.
Became a judge in 1972.
Yes.
And passed away in 78 at a very young age. Now, my father, I still have that photograph. I can call for that photograph right away.
Yes.
In 1970, he invited Mother Teresa to his club.
Acha.
And she was going to open an orphanage.
Okay.
In Jabalpur.
Yes.
And the Rotary and through him Rotary helped Mother to set up that orphanage. I saw these things from day one.
Yes.
It was part of my family culture.
So it's nothing new for you that when there is a problem, you will help people possible for you.
So when there was an earthquake in Jabalpur, I was the president of Rotary in 97. With all the clubs together, we built a new village of 66 homes, which was destroyed in that earthquake. When there was this huge cyclone in Odisha, as an advocate general, I stood on in the railway station after an appeal which I had made.
So this is about politics for you.
Yeah, and we loaded one full train of 19 wagons of 17 tons each material for Odisha. And this was all people from Jabalpur and 8-10 surrounding districts who sent so much material that I had to engage a full train.
So this was not new for you?
No.
You would have done it before?
We set up a hospital in Bhuj.
When was this?
This is 2000, I think, or 2000 when they had the earthquake.
So even the Mr. Narendra Modi was Prime Minister?
I'm sure, no, he was Chief Minister. No?
He was Chief Minister, yes.
I mean, I don't even remember that.
Yeah.
And we were not doing it for Mr. Modi. We were doing it for the people. I don't remember.
So this was for Rotary?
Rotary. And there were only five or
so
six.
So it is irrespective of the government of the state. You were just doing what you would do in any problem.
I'm talking of 2000 when this happened.
Yes.
Earthquake to 2000 or 2001, I don't recall.
Yes.
They set up six temporary hospitals.
Yes.
Five by nation states, and one was by my people of Jabalpur, which I had coordinated.
So this all is about politics for you. You do it because that's how you've been brought up.
Yeah, it's my passion. It's my way of life.
Okay, I'll go to Varun at this moment. Varun, you are an advocate in your own right, practicing in the High Court of Delhi, also courts across Madhya Pradesh, including the Jabalpur High Court. Well, we got to know you also, and we looked up, you set up your own website for helping students. Could you share a bit about how that was done?
So, as he said, it was his idea. It was because he's not one of the most tech-savvy people. So, I thought, you know, the execution,
I would, in executing that
idea for sure.
Yes.
Now, as he said, that we were getting mails, calls, letters from all across the country.
Yes.
Now, since there was a lockdown pan-India, we personally cannot go out.
Yes.
And help them. So the next best thing we thought would be to actually identify these people and actually ensure that their plea reaches the government.
Okay.
There were a lot of government outlets as well. There were a lot of models that even the, for example, there was a helpline by the Chief Minister that was started in Madhya Pradesh. But the response that we were getting from a lot of people was that even though they're registering there, their complaints are not being received.
Okay.
So what we decided was that we should start a portal where people from across the country, but there has to be one common link. That common link was Madhya Pradesh. So we had three kinds of people in that. One was people stranded outside Madhya Pradesh but wanting to come to MP. Second is people stranded in MP but wanting to go out to these other states.
Okay.
And the third is people stuck within the state of Madhya Pradesh, maybe different districts.
Okay.
So, and our help was twofold in this. One was registration, compiling the data, assembling it, and then segregating it state-wise and district-wise. And then personally, I have sent those emails obviously from his email account because it has to go officially through an official channel. So we sent those emails out to every single nodal officer, the chief minister, the chief secretaries, the principal secretaries, or any other person who was involved in that. That was the first aspect of it. The other aspect was where we would actually help them get e-passes. Because a lot of people, although they knew that they needed an e-pass, they didn't really know the procedure, how to go about it. Because you see, what happens is you have to inform the authority from where you're leaving, and also the authority where you're reaching also needs to be informed. And these are all district collectors that they were given their responsibility. So we would coordinate with both these authorities, ensure that they have the proper documentation and form. We would actually physically help them also on the phone, through them, guide them as to how to find how to fill up the form and help them get through this process. So I think in any way, wherever we could ease their pain and make them reach their homes as soon as possible, I think that was the aim of this whole idea that was there. I did it along with initially it was just about 15-20 lawyers that were, they're all my friends from Delhi, from Jabalpur and from Gwalior, Indore. But you know, as in when people heard the response that we were getting, so we got almost about complaints from 32 states and union territories.
32 states?
Yes, the number of people that were affected were almost 10,000. We got about 2,500 calls because we had a hotline running. And we had about 6,500 applications, complaints, registrations, so to speak. Because every registration, you could register for a group as well. So therefore, although the
registration... And this is all within India?
This is all within India. This is all within India and within the state as well. So then we would segregate state-wise, make Excel sheets, give them permanent
addresses. So it's not MP, you also eventually reached out to...
See, because what was happening is that because the transportation was happening from and to, right? So it would the buses would go from MP to, let's say, Kerala and then would come back to MP. So it was a quid pro quo. So because the central government had come out with notification that two states can actually get together
your website helped gather the data.
Gather the
and
data.
Send it rightly to every ministry. Every minister, chief minister,
chief secretaries and nodal officers. So that they don't have to do anything. We compiled every single data, we excelled it, everything properly, tabled it. And that was the idea behind.
Interesting. I'll go to Mr. Tanka. I want to know, was this Varun's first experience in working for such a big pandemic, or earlier also he has worked with you on such, because he practices independently. So, but has he got the opportunity to work with you on any such issue earlier?
Two places he's helped me before.
Yes.
One is, I have these schools for special children,
okay,
which I run in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. I have five of them.
Five schools.
I have about 800 children.
800 children are studying. These are all special children.
Special children from the poorest of the startups.
Yes, yes.
And these schools were first established. First school was first established in 1997.
Yes.
And was inaugurated by the then Chief Justice of India, Justice G.S. Verma.
Okay.
Who was my father's contemporary, very good friend. And since then, we opened five more. And Varun has been helping in those schools also, as and when.
But as far as the pandemic is concerned, first brush with...
And then when I have these medical missions, Rotary medical missions, we call them Rahat. Rotary's active hands are touching.
Okay.
And where, like the last mission was in Mandala,
yes,
from 7th November to 14th. And these are government statistics. About 1 lakh patients had turned up.
1 lakh patients.
1 lakh. And about 650 doctors from all over India, be it Vedanta, AIMS, Max, Fortis, Gangaram.
All of them have come.
Bombay Hospital.
Okay.
You name it. Huh. I mean, every hospital participated.
But coming back to this pandemic at the moment, and you told me when we were discussing this interview and I wanted some information, I called you up and you told me that Tarun, I have just spoken to the Chief Minister of Rajasthan to request him, a lot of kids want to go to Kashmir and he was kind enough to arrange the transport. How did that happen?
What happened is, I was getting these calls from Asif,
yes,
one of our coordinators for Asif, very good person, Asif. Yes. Who was helping the Kashmiris,
yes,
and especially the students all over the country. We'd also filed a petition, by the way,
yes,
in Supreme Court.
Okay.
And Varun had, in fact, filed it, his office.
Okay.
And before it could reach the court, yes, we had got the relief. You know, they had opened the doors.
Yes.
But more than that, Asif called me and he says about nearly 2,000.
2,000?
Students and others.
Others.
From Kashmir are held up in the state of Rajasthan. And since we are not able to coordinate, because there is no nodal officer.
For Kashmir.
So there was nobody who you could talk to. And
so Kashmiris were stuck, 2,000 Kashmiris stuck in Rajasthan.
Rajasthan. So Gerudji called me for something else. He called me for some legal advice.
Yes.
So after he finished with the legal advice, I asked Gerudji, I said, please help my Kashmiri.
Yes.
He says, अरे तनखा साहब, मैं तो सबकी मदद करता हूँ, क्यों इनकी क्यों नहीं करूँगा? तो I told him, I said, आपके यहाँ तो नोडल ऑफिसर ही नहीं है, तो कैसे मदद होगी?
बिल्कुल.
हंस के मैंने बोला.
Yes.
He said, नहीं नहीं, आप ऐसा करिए, मेरे सेक्रेटरी को कल किसी को बोल दीजिए, नोट करा दे और हम उनका तुरंत अरेंजमेंट कर देंगे. एंड बिलीव मी, इन 48 आवर्स एट द एक्सपेंस ऑफ राजस्थान गवर्नमेंट,
yes,
all transport was arranged.
Yes.
And everybody who wanted to go to Kashmir could leave in 48 hours.
Okay. Then what intrigued me was, this was one thing that you did for students in Kashmir, but the medical students problem particularly came to my attention. First of all, we were not aware that so many medical students are outside India, numbering in thousands.
I didn't know.
Thousands.
I didn't.
You're telling me Kyrgyzstan.
Even today, 102 students are registered with me. I've just sent the list to.
No, but there are other countries like Kyrgyzstan, Russia, one more country. You told me one more country. This was
Dubai. I got a very long, from UAE. I got a very long.
So studying
list.
Medicine in so yeah, India.
No, they may not be doing medicine.
But Russia and Kyrgyzstan, of course.
100%. There were thousands of students.
Medicines.
100 students.
Varun, were you also aware that so many Indians are studying medicine?
In fact, I was surprised myself when I saw the list.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, and I said, and they're not just students. I mean, for students from Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh also to be there.
They're in studying medicine.
Studying medicine there. I mean, it was baffling. I mean,
It was in hundreds.
I mean, and
so there's Rajasthan, there is Kyrgyzstan, there is Kazakhstan,
and then you suddenly see that you don't realize that
you realize India is such a big country
that even now students from Madhya Pradesh are in a country like Kyrgyzstan or Russia
and studying medicine.
So
it's inconceivable.
Of course, and that's why your heart goes out to them, that you know they must have gone through so much difficulties to actually get those admissions, get there, to get the transports arranged, and then you know then they're stuck there, they can't come back. You know, so just see the plight of the parents as well.
The hostels are closed. The messes have been closed.
No food.
Yeah. There were girls who called me from Jabalpur in Pune. You know, Pune is a student city.
Students have, yeah.
This was April, May, Varun. I remember. I made them speak to you.
Yes.
I was getting calls from these students from Pune and Bombay and, of course, Delhi. Lots of them in Delhi.
Yes.
And they were all appealing to me that, uncle, please arrange for us. We want to go back. And I said, beta, what do I do? And even if I get you a pass from Pune, will you reach Jabalpur?
Yeah, but you told me a lot of people were crying, saying we'll commit suicide if
not
you don't.
Lots of them. I've been writing.
There's so in so much of
you have to read those letters to
mean there's no food, they're stuck somewhere
and they're helpless, emotionally stressed, financially drained. You can't imagine what happened in this lockdown. I mean, it's fine for people like you and me. We are staying in our homes, there are people to look after us, there's food being cooked for us. The only thing is we stay safe. We don't go out or we wear masks.
That's the only restriction.
But look at them, they're away from their dear ones. Thousands of miles away, there's nobody to look after them, they're looking after themselves, not treated too well in these pandemic times.
Yes.
You know that.
Yes.
The attitudes change.
Yes.
So I was really appalled by what I saw. I mean, frankly speaking, the more I see it, the more I realize there's so much unhappiness in the world and so much of sadness in this world. Why can't our politicians address this?
I want to make a quick observation I want from you is that when you see this, thousands of people suffering, and India is a big country, 130, 135 crore people, do you think that in a vibrant democracy, politicians have a much, much important role to play? Because if you single-handedly, just by using your office, phone calls, mails, pursuing people, of course you contributed financially to lawyers, that apart, you can actually make a lot of difference as a parliamentarian if you decide on yourself.
Even for Kashmiris, for instance, one day Asif told me that about 55 Kashmiris are not able to make their two ends meet in Bombay and other places.
I mean,
they must have sent appeals. He says, Tanka Saab, can you send some money to them?
Yes.
Next day I transferred whatever little I could to 55 people.
I will go to.
They were in
bad shape.
You can't imagine what was happening? I mean, nobody is from a rich background. How many people are there from rich background?
In a country like India, minuscule. Hardly any people have
these
money.
These are all middle class children, middle class people. They're, you know, they're out of pocket. The parents also must be out of pocket.
Yes, yes, given these conditions.
And they were not working, I'm sure, in their places.
Yes.
Work must have stopped, salaries must have stopped.
Yes.
And you were still paying rents.
Yes.
And the landlords, I mean, we got so many cases of landlords fighting, you know.
Is it so?
Yeah, yeah. And I would intervene with officers to please advise the landlord.
Yes.
To stop fighting. This is not the time to fight.
Yes. I'll go to Varun at this. Varun, I want to know from you, when you saw so many people, you got a first-hand experience through your father and then working with him, that in India, so many people are needy. The state is not very strong in India. It seems strong, at least in the prosecution end, but otherwise the state to provide help is not that strong. And that you witnessed because you yourself wrote so many...
At least it needs a nudge.
Yeah, it needs a nudge. What has been the learnings for you working? Because one needs to be very lucky to get to work with somebody who's a Rajya Sabha MP and has the power to intervene and get things done. What is the learnings for you? Can you, if you can count on, say, one, two, three?
So, something very interesting. So, when I was in college, like a normal college student,
yes,
my mother would always tell me that, you know, she's like, you know, there are people who look for role models. There are people who try to emulate or try to be like somebody else. He said, you have one at home.
Yes.
You don't have to go very far. And I'll tell you, he doesn't even bat an eyelid when he's trying to help people.
Yes.
And when he's helping them, for example, when I went to Mandla, so when you see the smile that he has and the happiness that he gets in just helping and providing to those people, I think one needs to inculcate that attitude and that happiness that you that you get. Unless and until you do that, I don't think so. I think your social work will always be superficial. You need to get into the nitty-gritties of it. I mean, I've seen the kind of planning that is that he does when you do something like even for a Mandla camp or even during these times. Because I was hands-on there, so I mean the kind of coordination that was required. We had to send 13 to 15 lists to every state, and we probably got responses from them for one list or two lists or three lists. But we continued. We kept sending them. So I think you have to be persistent.
So even in India, even to help people is not an easy task.
Easy task. So
because you're not doing it for yourself.
Yes. So you have to, it has to come from within. You need to be happy doing it and you have to be persistent. And of course, you need
so
to have
a good heart. So basically, you told me you are realizing that in India, you are in a position where you are getting no gain, but you are helping people, even then there will be problems.
Of course.
Even to help people is a problem where you are not asking a favor for yourself.
That's right. But then what you also realize is that you will get a lot of people, when you do a good deed, or when you try to do a good deed, when you start it, along the way, which I have seen with him and which I saw even during my Rahat Corona, the website that we started, that a lot of good people join in.
Which includes government officers and all.
Everybody joined. I'm talking about private individuals also.
They will do what's in their case.
Yes, they all do it. So I think somebody needs to take that initiative, and I think that somebody who will take that initiative is probably somebody like him who loves it, doesn't do it for any other benefit, for any other gain. I think it has to come from within.
Okay, I'll go to Mr. Tanka. I want to know from you in a final comment on this show that when you do such a thing. And we are going out of the way to doing for no political gain. But you told me that political adversaries politically also help you in this. You call them and they are receptive.
100%.
They are always.
100%. Cutting across party lines.
There's no issue.
In my human programs,
yes,
I never encountered any difficulty.
So you call up, you told me that you spoke to the Civil Aviation Ministry and the work happened. You spoke to state governments who are...
Yeah, yeah. We got replies from Kerala, from Tamil Nadu, from Punjab, was our government. Uh-huh. So many, I'm forgetting, I mean, every day.
This is about politics.
It has to be because it doesn't, there's no name.
Yes.
And for the people you are sending, you're helping possibly, all of them even would not know who's helped them.
Yes.
And I'm not doing it for that reason.
It's probably the one who's only sent the mail.
He would know. And I don't know how much he would know because he may have asked 10 other people
whom
to
send it to.
And he would thank all of them at the end of the day.
Yes, yes.
It's fine. It doesn't matter.
So you mean you do it for your satisfaction?
I do it for myself. I'm happy doing it. It's my passion. And I think this, at the end of your life, you should go a happy person.
Okay. So I would like to thank you so much for sharing your experiences and how you helped people, and Varun also for sharing your experience in working with your father, Mr. Tankha, and you know your experiences in how difficult it is to even get good work done when you yourself are not getting work for yourself. So I would like to thank both my guests for sparing their time today, and as we saw when we came to the so they're still working on this issue because the pandemic has not truly ended as yet, but viewers, we'll revisit this issue later, but I would like to thank all of you who watched this show today, and thank my guests for sparing their time. Thank you.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.